And, you know, not to be outdone, Lynn, I love you. Great, great words and great music. I'm a firm believer that sometimes the best message in worship is the sung message. And our commercial moment, choir practice, begins September 6th. And we hope that you can join us and shed your voice to the spreading of the good news of Jesus Christ by song. You know, I was excited to give this message. I was excited to give last week's message. I laid in bed last night and said, man, I wish it was 10:45. You know, last week I talked about what it means to be married, what it means to have a body of Christ marriage, what it means to turn to your spouse just because and say, I love you, and I'm here for you. And how powerfully does that speak into our everyday life, in our friendships, in our workships? You know, we can't go around the workplace understanding, you know, going, you can't go up to the boss and say, you know, I love you. You know, but in your heart, you love them. And how do we have healthy and vibrant relationships at last? In our friendships, in our fellowships, in our churchships, and even in our worships. That's what the scripture is talking about in Romans this morning. The Apostle Paul is saying, we need to treat all relationships as important. And unless you speak Spanish, Trina, I don't know if you're going to understand that one. Are you? Okay. We had a guest last week that didn't speak English. So Trina, awesome idea. I printed out last week's message and this week's message in Spanish. So if we run into that gentleman, we can give him the messages. And the only thing I cannot, I don't know the sentence structure. Because I transferred, and sometimes when you transfer languages, sentence structure. So, but today's message is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 12, verses 9 through 21. Beloved, let's hear the word that God has for us this very day. And I love the first word to the message. In verse 9 it says, listen, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. There's that strength of message. Keep your fervor. Keep your power and your strength. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. That's why as I sat at the train track this morning for 15 minutes waiting for that train, I was fervent in prayer. And I didn't take control of the situation because there was nothing I could do about it. And even when he was done, I waved at him. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Oh, this is a good one. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice and mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people in low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, it's mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on their head. Do not be overcome by evil, but be overcome with good. This is not in my notes, but as I read the scripture, I thought of this message. There's a story about World War II. Americans and a Japanese prisoner of war camp. And you know what the Japanese hated? following the rules. They hoped that we would get angry and that we would fight back. But even in captivity, some of these American POWs held their composure and even held the respect for those that harmed them, for those that imprisoned them, for those that were horrible to them. Is that not what this scripture is talking to us about? When we go to our workplaces tomorrow morning, is that person that you work with sometimes hard to tolerate, especially on a Monday morning? My teacher's here. How's it like taking care of other people's children on a Monday morning? Well, actually, it'll be Tuesday this week. How do we love in relationship, and how do we love in a way that God calls us to love? This week, the Apostle Paul speaks to having healthy relationships. But I want to talk more about that in a second. Last week's message, I spoke about how to keep marriages healthy and marriages that last, marriages that are happy, and marriages that live in love. The keys that I gave last week for happy and healthy marriages were the following: that marriages are to be grounded on faith and in faith. And marriages can only work if we encourage one another rather than discourage one another. Is there a way to talk to somebody and give them advice without discouraging? Is that possible? And then finally, for healthy marriages, gleaning God's holy and written word for our marriages. Healthy marriages must be in God's word together and understand what God's word says for our marital relationships. Likewise, what does God's word have to say in our everyday relationships and how we deal with people that we know and people that we don't know, that stranger that comes upon us? And how is God asking us to treat that person? We had a person here last week, sat through the message, doesn't speak English. But you know what? He got it. How did he get it? Through some hugs, through some tears, and through tinfoil wrapped communion bread that we say, take this home. We offer you the bread of Christ. How do we keep healthy and vibrant relationships? As I prepared this morning's message, I found a great story on the internet. And it's a short story called Two Friends. Two friends talked and sang merrily as they walked through the forest. Suddenly, a bear appeared. The first friend quickly climbed a tree. The second one wanted to help, but his friend had already left him. He was very scared because the bear was big and strong and could easily kill him. He thought hard, and when the bear came near, he lay very still on the ground and controlled his breath. The bear came close to him and sniffed and smelt all over his body. It said that bears do not attack what they think are dead. The bear walked away thinking that the man was dead. The first friend then came down from the tree when the bear went away, and he asked his friend mockingly, "What did the bear tell you?" The second friend thought for a while. "The bear told me never to trust a friend who escapes and leaves you when you need them the most." My story was always, if you're being chased by a bear, make sure you run faster than the other person. That was what I was always taught. My friends, this story that we see is about trust. And the key factor in any healthy and vibrant relationship, in a marriage relationship, in a boyfriend relationship, in a girlfriend relationship, and in a friendship. Friendship. Trust is the essential key. And this morning, Paul is presenting the benchmarks for healthy relationships and healthy friendships. You see, Paul understood, as we do, that we will have friends that call themselves followers of Christ, as well as friends who have yet to come into a relationship with Jesus Christ. Around our communities, our country, and our world, you hear stories of broken relationships, stories of bitterness, stories of hatred. Just as in the time of the Apostle Paul's ministry, factions had formed and relationships were bent, relationships were broken. Paul speaks to the fact that any key relationship to be trustful and healthy must be grounded in what you think? Love. Any healthy and vibrant relationship must be grounded in love. Maybe even that love that God told you, Kay is going to be the one that's going to be your wife. How do we love one another? How do we love the one we sit next to? How do we love the one that sits in front of us or behind us, that works in front of us or behind us, that we encounter on the street that says, I'm hungry, I'm thirsty? Is it grounded in love? Now friends, the first test to any healthy relationships that are going to last is love. Paul tells us this morning that love is the unflagging standard and benchmark of healthy relationships. When was the last time you had a relationship that was healthy that had hate involved in it, that had revenge involved in it? Was that a healthy relationship? When our relationships face evil, God calls us not to resort to its tactics, but instead to seek out overcoming evil with good. Even Christians cannot control the actions and the attitudes of others. We are called to seek peace with all people. Did you notice that God doesn't seek peace with people just like us? He says, don't seek relationships with people that are just like you. Seek out relationships with everybody. Likewise, when we invite people to this table, what do we say? All are welcome at this table. All are invited to partake in God's blessings. And we are even called to love those who have wronged us. Is that not difficult to do? But still, God calls us to do it. Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 1, verse 17 and 18, tells us the following. May the God of our Lord Jesus Christ enlighten our eyes and enlighten our hearts so that we may know the hope which God has called all of us to. My friends, the world is blind in so many ways, and our hearts are heavy and unhealthy with anger and mistrust. Just watch TV for 5 minutes. Watch the news. Only through the love of God put forth through Jesus Christ can we truly make love our unflagging standard. The world over. So we as God's people can open eyes and enlighten hearts of God's creation. The gospel text from Matthew in today's lectionary speaks to our responsibility as followers of Christ in the task of creating healthy, trust-filled relationships. If you have been called into a leadership ministry within our church, the Gospel of Matthew chapter 16, verses 21 through 28 tells us that we have been called by God to the responsibility of teaching that as Christ died on the cross, we have died to ourselves and become servants that live out the following. As followers of Christ, our lives are no longer our own. You see, our lives have been paid for already on the cross. Yes, we have been saved, and our salvation entails our death to the world through the life lived out for Christ. Paul is brutally honest in this letter to the Romans this morning that our lives as followers of Christ will be difficult. There's nothing in the Bible that says, I never promised you a rose garden. There will be difficulties in our life, but only through the power of the cross, the life, death, and resurrection in Jesus Christ can we understand the kind of love, this agape love, that we as followers of Christ are to live out. To have relationships filled with love, relationships of trust. Our standard is clear this very day. And the Apostle Paul makes it very clear that Christians are to attend to others in love and to work with one another to alleviate pain and to alleviate suffering. How can I make your life better? How can I let you know that you are loved? How can I know that you are appreciated, respected, desired? What word do you use in your friendships and in your relationships? Do you build up or do you tear down? Do you encourage or you discourage? What are the very first words out of your mouth when you face somebody for the first time during the day? Encouraging or discouraging? What is God asking of you in your earthly relationships? We have a purpose, we have a goal, we have a standard that Jesus Christ lived and died and was resurrected for. We have a task and a responsibility in our lives as the Father's children. Recently, many of us have been working to alleviate the suffering of those affected by Hurricane Harvey. Like many agencies that have prepared for upcoming disasters, such as Hurricane Harvey, our call as servants of God is to be prepared as well. And we're called to be prepared to make and to live healthy relationships, healthy friendships. We are to be called God's living and breathing disciples of Christ. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit to serve the Lord. We have been claimed by Christ, and especially now, we are to be what we are in Christ Jesus. We must not waver. We must seek out ways to be committed in serving God. Just as God called Peter in the Gospel of Matthew, He calls us this morning to a ministry of trusting and healthy relationships. Just as Jesus was Peter's coach, let us allow Jesus to be our coach this morning and follow the Savior's game plan. Beloved, through Christ, we have already won the victory. Let us take that victory into our earthly relationships as our seal to win. And let love be our unflagging standard. Three ways for trusting and healthy relationships. Easy to remember. Love. Goodness. Attend to others. And never abandon a friend when it bears at their feet.